is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Spoil Me, covering Veronica Mars, Season 3, Episode 5, President Evil. In this episode, a dude gets forced to donate his bone marrow. Is that how that works? I feel like that's not how it works. Also, I'm really frustrated with Veronica this episode. Welcome to Spoil Me. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha. Thank you very much to Nancy for commissioning this episode, and hello to Rachel, who is in the chat. Rachel says these last few episodes being so close together has really thrown me for a loop. Yeah, same. I didn't realize there was another one happening in the same week, but I'm happy to be getting on to the next episode this quickly, so I'm not complaining. But yeah, thank you, Nancy, for doing that. So this episode has a lot of different things going on. I also wanted to mention, I completely forgot. Last episode, I got so wrapped up in talking about the implications of a rape case and the way the show is choosing to deal with it that I completely left out what happens with Keith and his new client. Because basically, he gets approached by a woman who suspects that her husband is cheating. This actress is incredibly familiar to me, but I couldn't place what I knew her from. She's from some show in the 90s, I feel like. And she is vibing with Keith pretty hard. And it becomes clear to him that he is low-key like hoping that her husband's having an affair, because that would mean that she would leave him and then he gets his chance. But it turns out that her husband is not cheating. They are just in their regular old roommate loveless marriage. And she was on Just Shoot Me. Thank you, Rachel. That's what it is. And she says something to Keith about how she can't just leave for herself. She needs a reason. Which is one of those things that sounds really annoying and stupid, honestly is the way a lot of marriages work. And I think that's part of what happened with me and Brendan, and part of why I started to get involved with Owen was because, like, I felt as if we were just going to keep on in this holding pattern of both of us being really unhappy unless somebody did something. And I low-key like decided to be terrible in order to speed the process up. So as much as a part of me is like, why can't you just leave for you, girl? Come on. I understand where she was coming from. And that's what makes it so heartbreaking when it turns out that he is not cheating. And it's clear she has been operating under the assumption that he definitely is. And it's just a matter of time before she finds out about it. And so she's kind of like making time for Keith under the assumption that there will be a time coming up pretty shortly in which she will be able to actually be with Keith, whether that means, like, you know, a serious monogamous thing, or if he was just going to be a rebound that she slept with, who knows. But once she gets the news that he actually pushed this woman away and told her, no, I'm married, we can't do this, you know, she gets up and kind of rushes out of there. And you can see that Keith is very saddened and disappointed. And it was a moment where I'm just sort of like wondering what is going to happen there. Like, I don't know if that was just the 1 week thing, if she'll be back at some point and they've established this, because they did have really good chemistry. But I'm feeling a little bit sad for Keith right now. You know, things, he's been lonely for a minute, and I wouldn't mind seeing him get involved with somebody and be happy. So anyway, let's jump into the actual episode where Veronica is showing Claire, the girl who was raped, the photo of the guy at the ATM with her. I don't understand what's happening here. I'm gonna be honest with you guys. I have a theory and I don't really like it. So I'm loath to even share it, but I'm kind of like, is that the thing? So she goes up to Claire, asks her, do you recognize this guy? Claire says, I have no idea who this dude is. Also, he made me get my daily max off my ATM card, so I got raped and I paid for the privilege. Veronica's looking at the logo on the guy's shirt, which is almost clear enough to read, and is like, can you see that? What do you know what this is? And the girl says, I'm sorry, I'm just useless today, and walks away. Veronica scans the photo and uses some like photo resolution software to sharpen the logo so that she's eventually able to read it, and it's like Waterloo Summer Camp or something. And she gets in touch with them. She puts on this like amazing like Southern churchwoman accent, which I really did enjoy, because I'll be goddamned if that is not entirely correct. That whole thing, she sounded like literally every woman I've met since I moved down here. But she is able to get a roster of all of the dudes who, or all of the people really of the last 3 years who went to that summer camp. And she pours through them, and there's only one Asian dude in Southern California who went to the summer camp. And when she goes to his house at the end of the episode, his roommate answers and she asks if he's here and shows the guy the photo in a moment that I honestly thought was ill-judged. He asks her, why are you looking for him? She's got Logan with her. And she says, we think that he raped this girl. And I was like, if he's not home, maybe don't alert his roommate that you're kind of on to him. Because I feel like that's just giving him time to prepare for when you return at some point and get his story straight. And just don't give him any sort of warning, girl. Go and come back, you know? But she shows the photo to the guy and he says, there's no way that's her boyfriend. Now, two things can be true here. One is that Claire was raped by her boyfriend, which is not fucking unheard of. It's certainly possible. The thing is that her head is shaved. Now, that's a weird thing, because it feels like this head shave thing is a serial rapist who is just like, you know, getting off on the power trip, and that happening with women that he doesn't know and enjoying having power over them makes a lot more sense to me than raping some other random women and then eventually getting around to raping the girl that you're actually dating. That doesn't feel like it makes sense to me. The other possibility, which I hate, is that Claire is pretending she was raped and asked for her head to be shaved so that they could have some ammunition against the school after she was threatened on that like joke newspaper, and basically say, you guys didn't take it seriously and look what happened. And she was never actually raped. She just got her head shaved so that it looked like she was. I can't tell you guys how much I will hate it if that is what it is. Really, truly. I really, like, I almost didn't even want to say it out loud, because I just, the whole idea of that makes me upset and angry. Like, Veronica last episode mentions the Duke LaCrosse thing. And for those of you who aren't familiar with the case, the lacrosse team at Duke was accused of gang raping a stripper whom they hired to come to their frat. And it turns out after the fact that she completely fabricated the whole thing. But in the meantime, everybody believed her story immediately. Like, I mean, the first time I heard about it was on Nancy Grace. And I remember where I was at the time. I was working in a hotel and they had the TV on in the lobby. And Nancy Grace was like absolutely crucifying these dudes. And I came to find out a week later that the girl finally came out and admitted that she was lying. And it was a real blow to every woman in the world who has legitimate rape allegations. The Duke LaCrosse false accusation is something that is brought up all the time by people who talk about false accusations. And I will admit to, like, with full transparency that at the time I would bring it up as well, because I was just so incredibly upset at how taken in I was by this story and to find out that it wasn't true, because a privileged white boy's sports team gang raping a black stripper felt like, you know, the way that privilege tends to work. It felt correct. It felt like that is something that would absolutely happen. I didn't even question her story for a moment. I 100% believed her immediately. And so I took it really personally when I found out that it wasn't true. And it was something that, like, since then I have become more educated and begun to see the way that the system works and understand false rape accusations almost never happen, because that, like, it's just not worth it. The scrutiny that you go through as a victim, a lot of women just don't bother because they know what they're going to be put through. And a lot of cops press women into dropping their cases because they don't want to, like, cops are just useless when it comes to sexual assault. So now I'm able to look back at the way that I talked about the Duke LaCrosse team case and be really embarrassed at, like, how ignorant I was and how I was using this one, like, hugely publicized false accusation to smear all accusers and pretend that, like, well, who knows now. But it really did a lot of damage, that fucking thing. And so that being brought up, and then we have this happening now where it turns out this dude is her boyfriend. You know, it's one thing. The thing that really is the question for me is why she told Veronica that she doesn't know who the guy is. This is one of those things that, like, maybe the roommate is lying. Maybe he's not her boyfriend. You know, like, I'm going by, yeah, that's totally accurate information. But let's say the roommate's telling the truth. If she lies to Veronica and tells her, oh no, I don't know him, and these two are still together, she has to know Veronica is eventually going to see the two of them together, right? You can't lie about something like that when you share a campus with one of the nosiest people ever born on the planet. She'll find out. And if you deny that you recognize him, after she went through a lot to get this photo, by the way, other people who do know that you are together are eventually going to hear that you denied you know who he is. And they are going to be like, that's her boyfriend. Now, the main question that I have is, if Veronica has this photo and all of these girls who were insisting that she prove that the frat was guilty were standing there when she handed the photo to the frat, did none of them see the photo and recognize this guy and recognize a girl's, like, she has been involved with this anti-rape group. I would have thought they would have been close enough that they'd know who each other's significant others are. So I'm just sort of like that. The main thing for me is how unsustainable this lie is that this girl told, saying she doesn't recognize him, she doesn't know who he is. It's just a matter of time before you're proven to be a liar. So why even bother? I don't really get what she's, like, getting out of this. The only possibility there that I can think of is she had no idea that she was with him. And she thinks maybe it was him that raped her. And she doesn't want to tell anybody that she knows him and that he's her boyfriend because she doesn't think anybody's going to believe her. That's something that I could understand. You know, plenty of people are raped by their actual partner and they don't talk about it because many people are under this like bizarre assumption that you can't be raped by your spouse or your boyfriend, which it's like, of course, you can, just because you've had sex with them before does not give them just a free pass to fuck you whenever. Like, that's not how that goes. But I could see that being like, if she had no idea that it was him and she sees this photo and realizes, oh my God, this is my boyfriend. Maybe she decides that she doesn't want to follow through with charges the way that she did now that she like has found out what potentially really happened. So we'll see. But I wanted to talk about that off the top because if it does turn out that this is a fake allegation, I'm going to be really, really pissed. So I just want you all to be ready for that because I'm not holding back. So let's go to Dr. Landry's class. This is a weird thing. Veronica is being called to present to the class. They're doing oral presentations and the TA is choosing who he wants to have come up, and he chooses Veronica Mars because he clearly just doesn't like her and he wants to put her on the spot. And the moment she says like, actually I'm not ready. And he says very well in this voice that's like so patronizing. And we find out the reason that she said she wasn't ready is because she is waiting for Weevil to show up. And now that he's here, she can continue with her presentation. Guys, I really don't know how I feel about this, like using Weevil as a test case subject dude. I'm not loving it. Now, here's the thing. Full disclosure, when I was in college, I took a, I'm trying to remember the name of the class, but it was something about like peaceful reconciliation, like learning the way that conflicts start and ways to resolve them using negotiation tactics and whatnot. And one of the things that we had to do as our end of the year project was present on an area that had conflict and give our assertions on like things that we think could be done to alleviate the tensions between two countries or within the same country. It was sometimes just different factions within a country. And I interviewed a guy I work with because he was from Sierra Leone and he was missing an arm. And those of you who are at all familiar with what went on in Sierra Leone know missing an arm is not uncommon, because that was a very common form of punishment, was cutting off a hand, cutting off an arm, frequently done. However, I did not bring him into class with me. I wrote a series of questions. I asked him those questions in an interview and filmed him. And then I cut together a video that we watched for my presentation rather than like, you know, putting him on the spot in front of the class. And that was of a very specific thing where this was like a person that I gave him full disclosure about what I was doing for class, the way that this all worked. I gave him copies of the questions I was going to ask before he came, just to make sure that he was prepared, because it was like heavy subject matter. This guy had been in the midst of some of the most gruesome, horrifying shit I have ever heard of in my life. And I didn't want him to be blindsided by some of the shit that I was going to ask. But the way that this is, so I'm going to read her She says, Eli Navarro has been in and out of juvenile detention since he was 13 years old. By the time he turned 16, he was the leader of the Pacific Coast Highway Bikers Club. By his count, he spent more than 700 days in juvenile detention facilities. He's currently on parole after assaulting the PCH gang leader who replaced him. And her TA is kind of like, girl, what are you doing? This isn't show and tell. And later on, we see that he is being allowed to tell his own stories. But I don't really understand exactly what it is that she's presenting on here. So I think that's part of why I'm not like sure how I feel. What is her thesis? She says, today, I'll talk about the socioeconomic conditions that lead preteens into a life of crime. Then I'll open it up to questions to both myself and Mr. Navarro. But I don't really understand why he needs to be here for this. And this just kind of adds to my feeling of Veronica using Weevil when she needs him, but not actually being his friend, even when, like, later on, that is really proven true when she immediately suspects him of this crime that I just don't know how she thought he was the one who did it. The fact that she immediately leaped to that conclusion for me was low-key unforgivable. And all Weevil does is fucking help her ass out. All he does is like be there when she needs somebody to do shady shit. And then she's like out here putting him in front of the class as like a curiosity. And something happens and she turns around and immediately blames him. And I really don't think much of it. I got to admit, it's very othering. And it is not her finest moment, in my opinion. There's like, Veronica is not a perfect character. Of course, she does things that she like realizes were impetuous or judgmental or whatever. But what's going on with Weevil is very different. Weevil's, her relationship with him and the way he's used by the show and by her has gone on for several seasons now. This isn't an isolated case where she made a bad call one time and it like blew back on her and she's realizing, wow, I really walked into that when I did something stupid. This is a pattern of behavior of her sort of treating him like an attack dog that she can turn around and sort of like scold or, you know, like, the way that she was about whether or not he killed the other PCHer, whose name I'm forgetting. He had a weird name, if I remember. It was Thumper, right? Which, like, I understand kind of being like, dude, did you literally commit murder, really? But, like, honestly, what was going on with them had nothing to do with her. And she isn't good enough friends with Weevil to justify getting involved the way that she was trying to get involved. And there really came a point for me where I was like, you really need to learn to mind your own business, Veronica. Like, that is not about you. You're not involved. He, you know, like, just leave it alone. And the way that this season has sort of gone on with, like, I mean, she tries to help him get a job, granted, but it feels like she's trying to get him jobs that, like, can help her out, too. It doesn't feel totally selfless. And then this and him being like held up in front of the class and his willingness to do it as well. I feel like were I Weevil, if I'm approached by Veronica for something like this, I'm absolutely not participating in this. Like, no question, kids. That is just not a thing. I don't want to be peered at by a bunch of privileged white kids when I am a person of color who has definitely been targeted and winds up like later being actively framed. And it would, I don't know. I just, it's sketchy. I don't like it. So yeah, she talks about him stealing his first bicycle when he was 6 years old. And then we get to a story that he's telling about drinking too much, smoking a little bit too much, and that his friend Hector comes in and says, somebody keyed my bike. And they find this guy's truck who did it. They hotwire it. They take it to a junkyard where there is a compactor to crush cars. And they leave the cube of the truck in the guy's driveway with the license plates on top. And everybody is really like laughing and smiling at this story. And you can see the TA sort of looking around in this irritated manner that he doesn't seem to like the way everyone's reacting. Now, I'm going to tell you guys my theory that I came up with about halfway through the episode, because what happens is Veronica tells Weevil about the casino dorm room. And she tells him like very specifically like what room it is and everything. So you know that that's going to come up. And she goes to that casino expecting to find Logan there. It turns out that he's in class. But the place gets held up by a bunch of dudes in masks. And they have guns, allegedly. And when one of them threatens somebody with a gun, but then chooses to like smack them in the face, I was immediately like, those guns are not real. Mm-mm. He would have shot into the ceiling or something if he was really trying to scare them and that was a real gun. That's what he would have done. He wouldn't just hit somebody. So those aren't real. And not only that, but Weevil knows that Veronica is smart. He isn't such an idiot that as soon as she tells him about a thing, he's going to go and hit that exact place right after she. It's like, it's insulting that she suspects him at all, but it's extra insulting that she thinks he would have been this fucking obvious about it. Like, in my opinion, that just as much as everything else is really rude. And she had like had on the necklace that Lily gave her, or that used to be Lily's. And he points it out, but then this person goes up to her and like snatches it right off her neck. And for her, that is a particular affront. So she vows to get that shit back. She says she after this whole thing goes down, she goes to his place and accuses him and says that it's somebody who was of similar height and build that broke in there right after she had said where they were going to be. And honestly, I didn't really feel like the dude was his height and build. He looked considerably taller to me, but I might just not have a good, you know, like might not be judging it properly in watching it the way that I was. And it was a combination of that. And like the guy is wearing gloves and he is wearing a mask, but you can still see his skin. And this dude is clearly a white guy. Like, it was very obvious to me. So I was sort of like right away, just like, no, it's not him. He's not wide enough shouldered. Like, these dudes do not to me look anything like Weevil. So I was really like combination of things like, Veronica, what are you doing accusing him? Seriously? And I loved his reaction of being like, I can't believe that you would think that I would do that to you after all we've been through. And she says, after all we've been through, can you really blame me? That's a really shitty thing to say, Veronica. Weevil may be a sketchy dude who has done a lot of fucked up shit in his life, but he has never betrayed you personally. Like, correct me if I'm wrong, guys. Has Weevil ever done anything to Veronica like that? Because he has a sort of his own code of ethics. And I feel like she has been very much off the table for, you know, to be targeted. And I don't really understand what she even thought his motivation was in taking the necklace from her. Like, the only thing that we can see that he got irritated by was when he finds out that she's still dating Logan, which was a weird thing that he doesn't know that, even though they've been dating for a minute now. I mean, it's been a while. The fact that he doesn't know is weird. But he reacts with, like, he's like, even after the way that Logan treated Lily, I can't believe that, and then walks away. So I guess what we're supposed to think is that she believes he's taking the necklace back because he doesn't think she deserves it, because she's, like, insulting Lily's memory by dating a guy who was really shitty to her. I guess. I mean, it seemed really like an afterthought that they were trying to take her necklace from her, to me anyway. Like, I didn't totally, that just the whole setup for this just all adds up to Veronica being kind of a garbage person and really falling into this trap of, like, judging him in a way that I think probably Weevil also thought that she just knew him better than that. And then to realize that she just kind of sees him as a potential criminal. I mean, you know, he admits in front of the class that he does miss doing his crime sometimes. He misses having money. He misses the thrill, yada, yada, yada. But, like, do you really think that he was going to give that impassioned speech about how he's really trying to go straight and immediately turn around and rob a, like, a dorm room casino at his work? The whole thing just felt, I just was so mad at her on his behalf the whole time. Rachel says, yes, we can blame you. She is such a shitty friend. Logan has never been perfect, ob, but Lily was cheating on him, not the other way around, right? Cheating on Weevil. I guess she was. Yeah. With Aaron. God, I can't believe she's fucking Aaron. That still makes me so grossed out. He is just so unappealing. Oh, cheating on Logan. Right. I'm thinking about how she was with Weevil. Oh, Lily. I forgot. I just hate this. I hate the way that things are going for Weevil this season. As a character, it was just so heartbreaking to see him get arrested before he could graduate the end of last season. And I want so much for things to, like, get better for him. And to see him be so not trusted by one of the people that I think he considered, like, a decent friend has got to hit him where it hurts. When you're trying to go straight, finding out that people still don't trust you can be a real blow. And, like, you'll understand why sometimes, but it's still, people putting their trust in you can motivate you to be better because you want to become worthy of the trust they're giving you. When somebody that you thought for sure you had proven yourself to be trustworthy still clearly does not see you that way, that hurts, you know? And I don't feel like Weevil's got a lot of options and a lot of allies in his corner lately. So he's sort of realizing that maybe he still doesn't, you know? Veronica helped him get a job. Whoop-de-doo. I mean, there is a point at which it's just me being, like, trying to prove to myself that I'm a good person, that I'll help you with a thing. So my theory had been, after we find the evidence in Weevil's car, Sheriff Lamb is the one that, like, pulls up and searches his car. And it turns out there was, like, a pizza ordered on a stolen credit card delivered to Weevil's house, which the cops just think, oh yeah, Weevil's such a criminal mastermind, he did this really stupid mistake. Whereas Veronica's reaction is, that is a really stupid mistake, and that does not feel like Weevil. And I'm like, yeah, no, it doesn't. None of this does, but I guess that's what it took. I started to think the TA is watching Weevil tell this story about crushing the wrong guy's car and not finding it amusing the way that everyone else does. I thought that was his car that Weevil was telling the story about, and that he had no idea who did it. Here's a dude bragging about it in front of the class, telling this hilarious story when he still, like, you know, who knows what happened with him with that car. And he decided to take out some kind of revenge because he was so enraged by that. And to be honest, I prefer my version because at least that feels like a very specific, like, grudge. But what it turns out to be is the two security guards, campus cops, who had tried to shut down this, like, you know, casino room a few times, and they never listened. And so these two dudes decided to kind of teach them a lesson and also, you know, get some money at the same time. And they decided to just pin it on Weevil because he's an ex-con, and they figured that it would be an easy thing to do and that people would believe them. And I guess it's a weird thing, too, because the guy who, the security guard, who is guilty and is the one that does a lot of the talking throughout that scene, kind of doing this, like, weird Scarface impression, he has a daughter, or maybe it's his, like, little sister, I don't know, but she is wearing Lily's necklace later in the episode, and Veronica had already run into her at the computer lab, and the girl was, like, a huge brat. And when Veronica, the way that Veronica, like, gets this guy to confess is she has the masks that they allegedly, like, ditched in this dumpster, and she tells him that they have a lot of their hair inside, that there's a lot of DNA, and if they want them back, she'll trade it for her necklace, and that's literally the only thing that she wants, and then they'll be square. And he tells her, I'm going to need a day to get your necklace back. But it turns out she's bugged. So the cops swing around the corner immediately and arrest this dude. The little girl comes at Veronica, screaming at her, calling her a cow. You treat everybody like dirt. It was a really weird move to have the little kid be this aggressive. But I won't deny that it was satisfying for Veronica to roll her window down and just grab the necklace off the kid's neck. I wasn't really mad about that at all. But the thing that all I could think as I was watching this is, like, if I'm a robber and there somebody says that they have, like, masks that have my hair inside and that it's a sack full of DNA, I don't know that I'm going to be as worried as I would have been 5-10 years ago. DNA testing takes a long time. It takes a lot of resources, and it takes, like, a really high profile case. That's the one thing that I could see working in Veronica's favor here, is that if this, like, holdup got publicized enough, and if there was enough outcry because they were all kids, maybe somebody does decide to do some DNA testing. But really, cops don't care when people get mugged. It's not like they can't, they don't do very much, you know? So honestly, were I him and she's like, I've got a whole sack full of DNA, I would just be like, all right, well, go use it, because it's not me. I don't know what to tell you. And I bet nothing happens. I bet you that, like, wouldn't really work out for her, because they don't really deal with that. You know, I had my car broken into, and somebody left their do-rag in the car after they stole my subwoofer, after they stole my stereo, they stole my registration, they took everything. And the cop looked at the do-rag and shrugged and said, I don't know, you can throw that out. We'll get you the report. And that was pretty much it. You know, they don't care. So anyway, it worked out in this case. And Veronica is able to, like, you know, get Weevil off the hook. But it's a really, like, it's one of those moments where I don't know that their friendship comes back from this. You know, I don't really want it to, if I'm honest. I feel like her deciding that he definitely did this and not trusting him and accusing him of being that, like, petty to specifically steal a memento from her murdered dead friend, like, I don't feel like she really deserves for him to forgive her for this. Granted, she did the legwork to make sure that he was exonerated. But honestly, that's the least she could do. So, I don't know. I feel really like kind of gross after that. Let's back up a little bit and talk about what's going on with Keith's new client. Because Veronica comes in and it turns out that she's like making fun of this car that's just like parked in a red zone and that they should call the cops and get it towed and yada, yada, yada. And it turns out that it's the dean's wife's car. And his wife is this like beautiful younger woman, very poised. And they have a son who it is her biological son. He married her, clearly really cares about this kid a lot and sees him as his own son. But what they tell Keith is that their son is dying and it's his dying wish to finally meet his biological father. And can he track the guy down and trick him into a meeting with these two, the parents? Keith, bless his heart, falls for this. And honestly, I don't think I would have seen through it. It seems like a reasonable thing. It turns out what's actually happening is that the kid is dying because he has bone cancer and he needs a donor. And this dude is compatible because he's the kid's father. And they are trying to pressure him into doing the right thing for fucking once in his life and coming through to save his kid's life. And he refuses to do it. There is, it's like one of those things where it's a really serious topic that's very like upsetting, but it's punctuated with fucking Cliff, who we haven't seen in a minute. And the way that they trick this guy is that he has been like scraping by getting voice acting work or voiceover work. And so what Keith does is like set up his office to make it look like it's an agency that does auditions and they get this guy in there thinking that that's what he's here for. And instead it's just a moment for him to be cornered by his ex-wife. And Cliff is out here doing these like amazing, you know, car commercial sort of voiceovers. And Keith asks him if he got that Olive Garden thing at one point, which leads to later on Cliff agreeing to like represent Keith because this dude winds up vanishing. And he says, when you're here, you're family. And I swear to God, I fucking cackled that, like that whole line delivery and the timing of it, him shoving the sandwich at Keith when he says it and the way it just smash cuts from there back to the college campus. It all just went together so well. I was really amused by that. Very. Cliff is a treasure. But yeah, this dude, he refuses to do it, which is just, it's one of those things that, like, on the one hand, honestly, what a monster. This is your child who you've never been there for. You're being given the opportunity to save his life as he dies painfully, and you refuse to do it because you are petty about your wife, which, like, literally burn in hell, dude, seriously. On the other hand, I don't know if any of y'all are aware of what being a bone marrow donor entails. It is kind of a big deal. Like, it's even more of a big deal, depending, than donating an organ. I mean, it is kind of an organ, but it's so much, it's a lot. I'll just say that, because I had looked into it at one point for somebody that, and I didn't know if I was a match or not, but somebody was in need, and I was kind of like, what exactly does this all entail? And it's a lot. And so there's another part of me that's like, I mean, this is your kid. You should absolutely do it. But also, holy shit, that's a lot. What happens is This guy disappears. Keith, who like pretended to be an employee of the state, I think the county, he got into the dude's room to search around in order to set up this whole voiceover gig thing. The police are now looking at him because he impersonated a state employee, which is against the law. And now this guy is missing. And so he's like their main suspect. Keith figures out probably that the dean and his wife are behind it and are trying to force this guy into being a donor. So he goes storming into the guy's office, the dean's office, and the dean tells him this sob story about how his wife took off with their son and they went to Mexico and he just didn't know what to do, but he didn't want to tell on them. And he brings Keith down to a very sketchy hospital in Mexico on a wild goose chase to distract him while his wife and son are actually back up in California still. I really hated how sketchy this hospital was in Mexico because a lot of people go to Mexico for medical procedures these days because it's less expensive because American medicine is corrupt and broken. And it's not like this. There's holes in the ceiling with wires dangling down and stuff. I guess we're meant to think that any place that would accept a clearly unwilling donor is going to be kind of black market. But then it turns out that he's in an actual normal American hospital just because she has a contact there because her brother, I think, is an oncologist. And I have got to ask, guys, is it even possible to bring in an unconscious donor and just have that happen? Because all I've ever heard is that you go through a rigorous screening process when you agree to donate an organ. They give you a cooling off period of a couple weeks minimum to make sure that you really want to do this before they allow you to undergo the procedure, because it is a traumatic thing. And it can have long-lasting effects on your body. And there are plenty of people who, want to help. And maybe they aren't told the full story. Or they want to help because they were, misled about something. Or they want to help because it seems like they're the only option. But then somebody else surfaces who can help who's, maybe closer family member or something. There are all kinds of reasons to, let this sit and be a... give people tons and tons of time to think it over. Rachel says, I don't think so. I don't think so either. And it's super unethical. You shouldn't be able to just knock a person out with a sedative and roll them in on a gurney and be like, oh yeah, this guy's marrow. Take this one. That doesn't feel like how that should work at all. Even if you have a contact in the hospital, there are so many people that would be involved in a procedure like that. And one would imagine at some point in that chain, a person's going to be like, we don't have this guy's signature on these forms, though, unless they forged them. I don't know. And then at the end of the episode, because Keith gets confronted by the dean, the dean's like, well, what if it was Veronica? What would you do? And there's this whole sort of weird. I mean, granted, the guy is garbage for not coming through for his son. But doing something like this is totally not okay either. This is the point of bodily autonomy. This is a really good example of people talking about women who should be forced to carry a baby to term, despite the effect that having that baby will have on their own body. And they're like, yeah, but another life is depending on you. This dude is a match and the kid is literally his child. But the state cannot force this man to give up his bone marrow to save his kid, because we understand bodily autonomy in a case like this. We know that that is not an okay thing to make a person do. They do not have that obligation. Women who are pregnant should also not have that obligation. They are full human beings and they should come first. But this show seemed to try and paint it like it was worth it in the end. This was a totally, they were boxed into a corner and they had to make a difficult choice, but wasn't it worth it to save this kid's life? And I don't think I'm really on board with this, kids. Essentially, Keith, like, is talking to the dean about how we're, you know, yeah, you guys are going to be going to jail. And the dean is like, I mean, yeah, but our son will be alive. So don't you think that's worth it? But in the end, it doesn't seem like they're going to jail. This dude seemed to have signed an NDA so that they wouldn't get in trouble. And he gets paid off with apparently a Ferrari is the deal. First of all, there's no way that somebody who donated bone marrow is walking around totally fine the way that this dude is just like a day later. It's just, that's not, absolutely fucking not. No. But secondly, this dude, he's like, let her know that I own her now. And, she, you know, we're totally square and yada, yada, yada. And I'm just like, y'all put yourselves in quite a position. I mean, even if he did sign an NDA, like, I mean, this whole plot was really convoluted. Both of these, this episode, between this and the thing with Weevil, and the way they both wrap and the way they're written so that it feels like the show wants me to have a certain takeaway, I'm just not. And I don't really know what to think. So far this season, I have not been impressed with the overall, like, tone and morality that it feels like they're giving things. I am not buying it. And I don't know what happened. Like, perhaps it will turn itself around. But after the last episode, I was kind of just like, what are they doing? And I'm even more that way this episode, even though neither of the main cases this time around really have a lot to do with the rape. I mean, we do have this thing at the end where it turns out this guy is her boyfriend. And so it feels like it's going down this particular path that I'm not excited about at all. So, guys, I'm really starting to get worried. Like, genuinely, I don't want to hate this. I don't want to tear it apart. And I absolutely will if that's what's coming. You know, you all know me. And I know how many people were excited about me covering Veronica Mars. But I don't, as much as, like, I don't apologize for being honest about how I feel about something, I also don't want to rip something apart that means a lot to people and that they love. So this is when I really start getting into areas where I'm, like, concerned about, you know, people are spending money commissioning me to cover this stuff. And if I'm just going to be angry and shit all over it, I'm going to feel bad about that. And I feel like they will also feel bad about that. You know, I'm getting into, like, where I got in the end of season 3 of Doctor Who, where I told Jamie, like, this is on the chopping block for me because I'm starting to feel like I haven't got anything good to say. And I don't want to be covering something that I keep feeling this way about. So I, you know, I'm not trying to say that's absolutely where it's going. Obviously, we're only 5 episodes into this season. It may turn around. These are long seasons. This show has probably, like, another, like, 15 episodes to go. But I can't lie at the overall, it feels like every episode sort of ends with a kind of message or something that we are meant to think at the end. And lately, what they've been coming at me with, I'm not on their page in any sense. And it feels really weird the way that it's being played to me. Rachel says, tear it apart if you need to. In my opinion, 1, not all the seasons or episodes are equally good. 2, this show is old enough that I feel it's fair to take a look back at it more critically, even if you loved it the first time around. I definitely look at things from a different point of view these days. Yeah, that's part of it as well, is like, people will be excited and want me to cover something that they haven't revisited in a while. And so they'll commission something and then realize, like, oh God, actually I misremembered how this went, or this didn't age well at all, or I forgot about this whole other section that's extremely problematic. And as somebody who has, like, revisited some things that I loved as a kid or, you know, in my teens, I know how that is. one of the things that's a prime example is for the book club, I covered dirty jobs, and it was a transphobic, misogynist, racist mess of a book. And so many people were super excited that I was covering it, but all of those people had not reread the book in the last decade. So they did not remember any of that. And meanwhile, I'm reading this book with my mouth hanging open in complete disbelief of how offensive it is and how repeatedly offensive it is and how blatant it is. And that anybody was like excited for me to cover this because I don't know what they are expecting me to say about it. And thankfully that episode was lost forever. Me and Krista, like, there was some technical issue and we just wound up being like, yeah, here's 10 minutes of us talking about that. This book was garbage and we're not going to talk about it anymore. But, you know, like I said, I don't want to pass judgment too quickly, but I just need you all to know where my head is at right now, because I'm very concerned at the handling of all of this stuff so far, knowing that the overall arc of this season is going to be dealing with a serial rapist. If they are not able to handle other subjects sensitively and with a wider scope and understanding, I don't see how they pull this off at all. So I guess we'll see. Rachel says, even the first time around, some of this stuff made me cringe. That's definitely fair. Well, thank you, Rachel. I appreciate you being understanding of that, because I don't want to let people down. I don't want to disappoint them. I don't want to ruin things for them. But also, I'm literally here to tell you all what I think. So I got to do my job. It's just, I don't want that to be my job. I don't want ruining things to be my job. So, you know, and there's also a possibility that this is going to be like, well, we wanted you to cover Veronica Mars, but season two was really what we were here for. Season one was really what we were here for. And we knew we had to, like, we wanted to finish it up, but we knew that you weren't going to like this last season. And that could also be part of it as well, because there are things that I'm covering that I'm like, well, we're going to have to just get through this part because this isn't great. And I know that going into it, and I'm fully aware of the problems. So it may be something like that. So yeah, it's fraught. It's fraught. But I am curious, you know, it's not like I'm not interested. I'll say that I'm not bored. I am very involved and engaged in what's happening, and I want to know what happens next. And I think about the show and like kind of go through the evidence in my head a lot. So it's definitely got my attention. I'll say that. I don't want you to, like, if something is offensive or doesn't handle subject matter well, that's frustrating. But the even worse for me is to be uninterested in a thing. That is the greatest sin of all. So at least they're avoiding that. You know? I think that's about it. I'm going to wrap up. But thank you, Nancy, for covering this. I'm sorry that I was so hard on this episode, but hopefully you guys all understand where I'm coming from. And I actually haven't checked. I think the next episode is like next week. Let me see. Veronica Mars. Here we go. What's today? The 26th. The next episode is on, oh, it's not for a month, July 24th. I think I saw this last time. And then July 28th, and then not until August 21st. And I'm booked into September now. I don't know if anybody has booked one and it's just not on the spreadsheet yet. But just giving you a warning that, you know, there is going to be a break in November for my wedding and honeymoon. So, all right. Thank you guys again so much for listening. And let me know what you think about my assertions here. And I will see you soon with a new episode. Until then, toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.